This episode of the Bonsai Network podcast is brought to you by Eisei-en Bonsai. Eisei-en is a full-service bonsai nursery located just outside of Nashville, Tennessee. To schedule a visit to Eisei-en, head over to www.eisei-en.com. That's www.eisei-en.com. Welcome back to a brand new episode of the Bonsai Network podcast. Before we get into the meat of this episode, I want to do a little bit of housekeeping here. And that's going to come in the form of a discussion and a follow-up to the previous podcast I did entitled Bonsai Hate Mail. So if you haven't listened to that podcast already, I recommend that you do that before you jump into this one so that you understand the context of the conversation. So in the show notes or the description of this podcast, I'm going to put a link to that episode so you can go back and check that out before you dive into this episode. So in response to last week's podcast, I got a lot of support emails from people all around the world, not only bonsai hobbyists who have enjoyed my work over the years or who are studying here at my school at Eisei-en, but also from various professionals who have been too afraid perhaps, or just didn't want to jump into the fray when it comes to speaking about that particular technique, which is hedge pruning. So I want to shout out to everybody who sent me some love via email, via text, via whatever outlet. Thank you so much for all of your support, and I really appreciate it. On the flip side of that, though, of course, I did receive some pushback from some folks around the world, which is totally understandable. This is a conversation worth having, and in my opinion, it's not so much a debate, it's more of a dialectic. So I like the fact that we can have a conversation about it. And there was a lot of constructive criticism from folks all over the world. So there were really sort of three main themes in terms of response to my original podcast in regard to rebutting what I had said in that episode. So I wanted to address these three themes here and just clarify a few points that I thought I had made in the last episode, but apparently it didn't translate very well. So I want to just make sure that we're all on the same page here, or at the very least that everybody kind of understands my final words on the subject. So the first of these contentions really revolved around the subject of aesthetics versus objective results. Now, the main pushback was that, you know, I have studied in Japan. I lived there for 9 years. I did a 6-year apprenticeship, stayed on for 3 years beyond that. So the way that I view bonsai and what I prefer aesthetically is completely influenced by my time in Japan. And I completely agree with that. But that is completely aside and separate from the discussion that I was trying to have in the last podcast. The whole point was to set aside those differences in aesthetic preference. So, you know, my preference for Japanese style bonsai versus someone who's trying to create some sort of European style versus an American style, or however you want to approach it. The point was to talk about the objective results that you get from applying certain mechanical techniques to plant species, which is why I gave the horticultural reasons, the scientific reasons, the hormonal reasons, and I even provided a scientifically peer-reviewed, published in a journal, paper that you could go and read about how these hormones interact within a tree and how they produce certain results. So in that last podcast, I was responding specifically to truth claims that were made by other professionals and other people practicing the hobby that hedge pruning will get you more ramification, softer ramification, and taper in the branch. These are all objective results that you will see, you know, if you apply hedge pruning to a tree versus proper pruning techniques that we utilize, you know, stemming from Japan. And we're going to talk about the history of these techniques in just a minute, because that was another point of contention. But you can actually see the results of these techniques applied to trees. These are objective results. So this has nothing to do with aesthetic preference. Now, I would make this analogy to painting, for example. So if you want to learn how to paint, you go to a painting instructor. And that painting instructor will first teach you sort of the mechanics of painting. So it doesn't matter if you're using watercolors or oil, it doesn't really matter at all. But they'll teach you, for example, that if you want to create a secondary color like green, you need to mix blue and yellow together. Now, if that painting instructor tells you that by mixing blue and yellow together, you're going to get purple, well, you might start to think about going to a different painting instructor, because those two colors mixed together are not going to yield purple for you. So, you know, that's separate and aside from whether or not you prefer learning how to do, you know, surrealism or pointillism or, you know, cubism, some form of painting. That's completely separate and aside from the actual mechanics of painting and mixing colors. It's the same thing with bonsai art and applying certain techniques to trees. You're going to get objective results from applying those techniques, and those are measurable and visible. The second point of contention and pushback that I got from some folks was that I was taking a very traditional approach to bonsai as influenced by my time in Japan, and that hedge pruning is somehow a modern technique and taking bonsai to a new level and new different directions. It's a better technique in that regard because, as we all know, tradition is a four-letter word, or at least it is in some communities, particularly when it revolves around art. But my point is that, and I want to be clear about this, that hedge pruning is a much older technique than proper pruning techniques that we utilize with deciduous trees that have come from Japan in recent decades. So as a matter of fact, if you look back through the history of gardening in Japan in particular, since we're on the subject of bonsai and it does stem from Japan for the most part, if you look back at the history of hedge pruning, there's a technique that's still utilized to this day in gardening in Japan called karikomi. Or okarikomi, if you're talking about hedge pruning large azaleas, for example, to create a giant mass of, you know, like a very aesthetically pleasing sort of mound of azaleas. But this technique, karikomi, dates back to the mid-16th century, or at least the term does, but the practice dates back, obviously, way before that. So the modern techniques, the techniques that we utilize in regards to deciduous material that I covered in the last podcast, for example, allowing the leaves of an alternating leaf pattern species like a hornbeam to elongate to 6, 7, 8 leaves long, and then cutting back to 2 leaves, choosing a bud in the direction that you want that next branch to grow, so on and so forth. Those are much more modern techniques. As a matter of fact, a majority of those techniques were developed post-World War II, specifically in the 1960s, 1970s, and into the 1980s, you start to see the results of those techniques having been applied for the previous 2 decades. So the contention that somehow I'm stuck in some tradition in Japan, and that's why I prefer those type of pruning techniques, is patently false and historically inaccurate. Now, the final bit of pushback that I received had to do with practicality and speed in terms of developing a lot of branching and, you know, a nice silhouette or an overall canopy on a piece of deciduous material by utilizing hedge pruning. So I will grant you, and I believe I did so in the last podcast, that hedge pruning will get you a lot of branches in a very short amount of time. But my whole point was that if you want to produce branch ramification on a tree, so lots of branching, fine branching on a tree, and taper and movement within the branches on the tree, you can't get all three of those with hedge pruning. Yes, you can get a lot of branching on a tree. It's not going to be very fine branching, and it's not going to taper. Now, again, taper is an objective term. It means to get smaller in diameter from point A to point B. So this is measurable. You can see this, as I said in the response to the first contention. But in any case, you know, the whole point was that, yeah, you can get that element. That's fine. If you want to have a tree that has a lot of branches on it, that's totally cool. If that's your, you know, value judgment and what you want in the tree, you know, to have that excess amount of branches on the tree to give you a nice canopy, to give you a full canopy, to give you a nice full silhouette, that's totally cool. But you're not going to get all three or all four of those results. So again, fine branching, lots of branching, movement and taper in the branches by hedge pruning. And again, this is an objective reality that is measurable and testable. So once again, I recommend that you guys apply all of these techniques to your trees, see what works for you. If you like one versus the other, that's totally cool. But again, you know, you're going to see those objective results. And from there, you can decide exactly what you like. Now, you know, we could talk about the sort of naturalistic approach versus natural approach versus idealistic approach versus, you know, modern over refined approach to styling bonsai. Those, again, are similar to painting in terms of, you know, liking surrealism versus cubism versus, you know, postmodern art, whatever it happens to be. But again, there are objective things that are going to yield objective results. So please keep that in mind. I hope that clears up, for the most part, any questions that folks had from the last podcast. But again, you know, if there's still things that you want to ask or that you want clarified in an upcoming episode, make sure to send your questions to podcast@bjornbjornholm.com. Okay, so now that we have that out of the way, What I would like to do for this episode is talk about some of the bonsai art that was created over the past few decades by my oyakata, my teacher in Japan, Keiichi Fujikawa. Now, you're probably asking yourself, you know, how are we going to talk about this in a podcast format because bonsai is quite visual? Well, I have an answer for that. So I'm going to put a link in the show notes or the description to this podcast to a website that has a gallery of trees that were created by Mr. Fujikawa, my oyakata, over the last few decades. So as we go through this discussion, you know, you can follow along, actually look at those photographs to understand exactly what I'm talking about and which tree I'm referring to. So, you know, I think it's pretty obvious, but don't do this while you're driving down the road. Make sure that you're sitting down, you know, not behind the wheel of a car or operating heavy machinery as you look at these photos, as we discuss them. You know, I know a lot of people will listen to this on their commute to work. So just keep that in mind. We don't want any accidents caused due to bonsai art. So the website that we're going to be looking at is actually, I believe it's a pretty much defunct website at this point. It's the artofbonsai.org, which was a huge website a few years back. It really compiled a lot of articles, or it was compiled of a lot of articles, you know, related to bonsai art. And there was, you know, there are a lot of galleries there from different professionals from around the world. There's even a registry of professionals from all over the world. The website is still up, but I don't think it's being posted to or operated on a regular basis anymore. But the cool thing is that the galleries are still there, so we can check those out. So go down below in the show notes, click that link, and we'll start at the top of the page here. So if you notice, the very first photograph here is actually a picture of Mr. Fujikawa. I'm just going to call him Fujikawa-san from here on out, my oyakata. And I believe I've talked about what the term oyakata means in the past, but just for clarification, oyakata translates to parental figure, but basically it means your teacher during your apprenticeship. And that could be bonsai apprenticeship, could be ikebana, could be a tea ceremony, anything. Where you're studying for a long period of time as an apprentice in Japan, you will have an oyakata. So Fujikawa-san is my oyakata, and you can see him there in the first photograph. The tree that he's standing next to is probably the most valuable tree at Kouka-en Nursery, his nursery in Osaka. And it's a collected Itoigawa Shinpaku that goes by the name of Hakuryuu, which translates to white dragon. Now, I got to style this tree in my fourth year as an apprentice, I think, coming up on the end of my fourth year as an apprentice. And you can search online, just search my name in Google, and you'll actually see me sitting next to this tree just after I styled it. Now, you know, if you look at how it was styled by me in that particular photograph versus how it looks in this photograph with Fujikawa-san, the photograph with Fujikawa-san is about 4.5 years prior to my styling. You can see it's already really well settled in. Fujikawa-san had styled this tree about 3 years prior to this photograph, so it had grown out. It had become kind of natural in appearance, soft, refined, but natural. It has that element of mochikomi to it that we talked about a couple podcasts back. Now, if you compare that to the photograph in which I had styled the tree, it looks almost ridiculously over-refined in the photograph with me sitting next to it, and that's because it was. There were a couple of reasons for that. One was that Fujikawa-san's personal preference in terms of how we as apprentices style trees was much more in line with what you see in the photograph with me sitting next to the tree. So overly refined, you know, every little branch kind of in the right spot. There were a couple of reasons for this. One was that trees that were styled in that manner, particularly when we took them up to the Kokofu to sell those trees, they sold very quickly relative to other trees that hadn't been styled in that manner. So there was a market value to, you know, applying those techniques to those trees and styling them in that way. And the second was that we weren't really styling the trees for that particular moment that you see it in the photograph. We were styling the trees with the understanding that that foliage elongates and then naturally lifts due to this process called phototropism, where the foliage will actually rise up and search for the light. So by over refining the trees and placing those branches almost completely flat on the undersides of the pad, within a year to 2 years, as the new growth elongates and emerges and rises, you get this really soft, elegant, natural lift on the tree. So I've actually put photographs of this tree up around online a couple years, 2, 3, 4 years after I styled it, with still the original wire that I had put on, and you can see a difference there. And again, I'll try to find a photograph of that as well and put that in the show notes so you can see the comparison of you know, this tree with Fujikawa-san here, me sitting next to the tree, just having styled it, and then 2 to 3 or 4 years later, the tree having grown back in and looking a bit more natural, but refined. So that element of mochikomi. But in terms of the background of this particular tree, it's pretty cool. Fujikawa-san's father, he was the one who started the nursery back in, I believe it was 1958. And Fujikawa-san was born in 1963, so just 5 years later. But in 1958, it was started as a flower shop. Eventually, it became a satsuki azalea shop, and then eventually it turned into a bonsai nursery in the late 60s, early 70s. So this particular tree right here was displayed in the Kokufu. I believe it was 1972, 1973, somewhere around there. At that Kokufu, Fujikawa-san's father saw the tree on display there and decided that he had to have it for his nursery down in Osaka. So following the Kokufu, he purchased the tree from the owner at the time, who was an amateur. He bought the tree from the owner and then brought it down to Kouka-en, and it's been there ever since. It's kind of like the the logo tree, if you will, for Kouka-en Nursery. Now, of course, the tree is for sale, and it's worth, you know, probably pushing seven figures, which may seem odd when you look at it in this particular photo here, but what you don't see are the details that are up underneath the foliage, which really add to the value of this tree. So the first thing that makes this tree, you know, killer is the fact that it's a collected, naturally occurring Itoigawa Shinpaku from the Niigata region of Japan. This tree would have been collected off of a mountain in that area called Kurohime, which translates to Black Princess Mountain. You can no longer collect there. So this tree would have been collected probably just after World War II, more than likely. So it's been in a pot for quite a long time. But the fact that it has nice natural Itoigawa foliage to it, it's not been grafted, that's its natural foliage. That's the number one thing that adds a lot of value to this tree. The second thing is that if you look up underneath the tree, and if you see this tree in person, it really stands out. There are some features just underneath the foliage mass there that are really powerful, very interesting. They're called edajin. And I think I may have talked about this in a previous episode, but just for clarification, edajin, I'm sure everybody is familiar with jin. Jin is basically dead branches that are left on conifers, and we paint them with lime sulfur to turn them a bit of a whitish color so they stand out, but it adds a bit of character and a feeling of age to the tree. Well, an edajin, eda translates to branch, so an edajin is basically a live branch that has naturally occurring deadwood, or even man-made deadwood sometimes, that intertwines with the live tissue on the branch. So it's almost like having a shari on the branch. And for those of you who don't know, shari is typically deadwood on the trunk. So it's almost like having shari on the branch of the tree. And it's actually a pretty rare characteristic in junipers and in any plant. So to find a tree with as many edajin as Hakuryuu has, that also makes it a very rare tree and a very valuable tree. So nearly every branch on that tree up under the canopy has some amount of edajin there. As a matter of fact, the lowest branch on the left side of the tree has actually extended over time, little by little by little. There's actually nothing connected between that foliage and where that tree emanates from the upper portion of the tree. There's no other live branches in that area. So that particular branch has the most interesting and beautiful edajin on it. And unfortunately, it's elongating more and more and more and stretching out further and further outside of the profile of the tree. And as a matter of fact, if you see the tree as it was styled most recently by me, again, actually earlier this year, I styled this tree one more time. And actually that will be the best opportunity for you to see what this tree looks like right now. I will post a link to a vlog that I did in Japan this year in January where I restyled this tree. I'll put it down below so you can check that out. But you'll notice that lowest branch on the far left side of the tree is actually quite far outside of the profile. It almost makes the tree feel somewhat symmetrical. And it's a little bit low towards the base of the tree. The problem is we can't cut that branch off because it's attached to the most powerful and beautiful edajin in the whole tree. So it's one of those, you know, compromise situations where that feature is so valuable and so rare and so interesting to the overall design of the tree that to cut that branch off would really destroy the overall look of the tree. So, you know, one option would be to try to take some of the foliage from an exterior branch on Hakuryuu and graft it further back in on that branch, but that's a bit of a difficult thing to do on such an old tree. And it would take years and years and years to be able to get a branch big enough to cut back to. So we'll just have to see how the tree develops over the next 10, 20, 30 years. But this tree is still at Fujikawa-san's place. And if you want to see it in person, you can definitely head down to his place to check it out. Before we move down to the next photograph in the gallery here, last thing I want to say is that metal cage that you see behind Hakuryuu and behind Fujikawa-san here, that is no longer at Kouka-en. It was actually installed by Fujikawa-san's father back in the 1980s. It's basically a metal cage inside of the metal fence of the nursery. So it's a fence within a fence. Back in the 1980s, when the bubble economy was happening and the value of bonsai were increasing exponentially and people were paying crazy amounts of money for, even shohin-sized trees. Fujikawa-san told me a story about a shohin shinpaku that his father had sold for $22,000 for a tree that was under 8 inches tall, under 20 centimeters tall from the top of the pot to the top of the tree back in the 1980s. Well, because the value of the trees were so high, and there was a lot of competition in the market, there was a higher potential for theft of trees and also a higher potential for sabotage of your competitors' trees. So to protect the most expensive trees in the nursery during that period, Fujikawa-san's father built this cage within the nursery to put those very, very valuable trees in. And it was far enough away from the edge of the nursery, or at least the main trees were far enough away from the edge of the nursery that herbicide could not be sprayed from the exterior of the nursery to kill those trees, because that was something that happened on a somewhat frequent basis back in the 80s due to jealousy within the bonsai, the professional bonsai community. So that cage today is no longer there. Number one, because it's not really necessary. Number two, because it started to fall apart. Let's see, I started my apprenticeship in 2008, I think. Yeah, 2008. It was already looking pretty rough by that point. So the cage was disassembled probably in 2010, I would say, 2012, somewhere in that range. So it's no longer there, which is great because it makes the nursery look way better. It looked like, we used to call it the jail. It looked horrible. It was black color with rotting pillars. It was just falling apart. So it's a good thing that it's no longer there. Okay, now that we've checked out that photograph, let's scroll down to the next picture here. Now, some of the photos in this gallery, I am not familiar with the specific trees in the photos, so we're actually going to skip a few of these, and I just want to talk about the trees that I am familiar with and that I've had some hands-on experience or at least been around those trees at the nursery. So this first photograph of a dwarf star jasmine, a three-point display with a Japanese flower and quince. We're going to skip over that one, but we're going to go down to the next picture here. This is another dwarf star jasmine, but you'll notice that it is a full cascade. So I don't think that dwarf star jasmine, Trachylospermum asiaticum, is the botanical name for this species. I don't think that it's become super popular outside of Japan. Every once in a while, I'll see some in the States or I'll see some in Europe when I travel, but they're not super popular outside of Japan. And the main reason for that, I think, is that it takes so long to develop a thick trunk on this species because it is a vine. So the trunks really don't thicken up. It takes many, many, many years. And they're quite difficult to build into a shape like what you see here. Now, there are ways to expedite the thickening of the trunk, and this tree was actually built using that technique. And that technique is taking the non-dwarf version of star jasmine and grafting the dwarf foliage to it. So the trunk on this tree is actually just the standard star jasmine trunk. And then the tiny, tiny foliage is dwarf star jasmine that has been grafted to it. Now, this grafting would have been done probably back in the mid-1980s, I would say, mid to late 1980s. And the picture doesn't really do it justice in terms of, relaying the size of the tree. This thing is absolutely massive. It says it's 70 centimeters from top to bottom, which is just over 2 feet. It's like, 2 feet, 4 inches, something like that. So you don't really get a sense for the size of the tree. It's very awkward to pick up, very heavy to move around. But this tree was one that was at the nursery when I was 16, and I went to visit Fujikawa-san's nursery for the very first time on that trip with Panasonic that I mentioned in a previous episode. This tree was at the nursery. I didn't remember it specifically from the trip, but I took photos of all the trees in the nursery while I was there, and a few years back I was flipping through those and I noticed that I had taken a photo of this tree when I was 16. And of course it was still there when I went back a few years later to start my apprenticeship. This is one of my favorite trees in the nursery, you know, mainly because we really didn't have any full cascade trees. It's not really something you see very often in Japan anymore. It's not a very popular species just because, or style, just because it's difficult to find a place to set it. And then to, you know, maintain the lower branches on the tree is always difficult. But this is one that I always had fun every year working on in the summer season. And what's interesting is that, you know, we talked at the beginning of this podcast about hedge pruning on trees. There are a handful of species that lend themselves very, very well to shearing. So essentially like hedge pruning, with one caveat in that we are very specifically shearing in a manner that's meant to produce an aesthetic result like what you see here. So shearing to create pads, basically. Because the branching is so fine on these trees, because they are vines, really the only way you're going to get this type of density on this tree is to shear it. So this species, sometimes azaleas lend themselves well to that karikomi technique that I mentioned at the beginning of the podcast, which is, you know, shearing or hedge pruning. Sometimes you can get this really cool effect. And the fact that this tree is a broadleaf evergreen, meaning that it holds or retains its leaves all year round, really lends itself well to this type of pruning technique. So you can really see what's going on here. And the cool thing about this is when you hedge prune something like this or shear something like this, you don't get thick, ugly branches. It's one of those species that, you know, the branching is so fine because it is a vine that it's not going to produce, you know, major wounds or major calluses in those areas. And you're going to get a lot of branching in a very small amount of space. And of course, this really cool silhouette. So again, I did mention this in the last podcast that there are exceptions to the rule, and this would be one of those exceptions. This tree, I don't think, is at Kouka-en anymore. I believe the owner of this tree, who is one of Fujikawa-san's really good customers, a guy named Endo-san, Mr. Endo from... where is he from? He lives near Lake Biwa, just on the east side of Kyoto. He owns an onsen, ryokan, like a traditional Japanese hotel. And he owns a boat rental company on Lake Biwa for, you know, lovebirds who want to go out and row the boat around on Lake Biwa. He owns that type of company. But he's got this tree up at his house in his private collection at this point. Okay, let's scroll down here. So the next two trees are both Japanese flowering quince or chojubai. I'm not familiar with either one of these trees, at least not in terms of them being at Fujikawa-san's nursery while I was an apprentice there. Although the first one of these two, the one on top here, that was there when I visited in, when I was 16, whatever year that was. That was at the nursery. I do have a photograph of it at that point. This tree also eventually made its way to Bonsai Nursery up in the Omiya Bonsai Village. That's Mr. Kato's nursery, and was sold for some exorbitant fee in, I'd say, probably 2012, relatively recently, maybe 2015. So I did see it again at the Kokofu at their sales booth there, but I'm not super familiar with it otherwise. And same thing with the one just below it. The next tree, again, is a Japanese elm that I'm not familiar with, and the following one is a Japanese white pine root over rock that I have never seen in my life, so we're going to skip those two. Now, the next tree is another Japanese white pine. This tree is a formal upright, so a chokan style. This tree, I actually styled this one, not for this photograph, obviously, because this is from probably the early 90s in the Kokofu, but this tree is also owned by Mr. Endo. And it's gotten massive since the photograph here. It was already 100 centimeters back then. It's now, you know, probably a good 20% wider and maybe 10% taller, 10 to 15% taller. So the canopy is much, much bigger, and the trunk is probably 50% larger in diameter. So it's really grown over the years. This tree is not grafted. This is a collected Japanese white pine, which is really cool. That it has that formal upright trunk and lots of skinny branches on it. Now, I'm not sure if these branches were grafted at some point in its life after collection. I don't think that's the case, but I could be wrong there. But it has this naturally occurring, you know, fine foliage on the tree. And I did style this one, I'd say probably 5 years ago. for Mr. Endo, not to put in the kokofu, just for him to have back in his collection. So when we carry this tree, because the branches on the bottom have extended so much further out than what you see in the photograph here, way beyond the edge of the pot, we had to build a special wooden structure called a tanka in Japanese, which is basically just a big carrying platform with long 2x4s for handles on both sides, so we could actually lift the tree and move it around. But this was inside of the cage for a couple of years, so I styled it. We keep it for I guess about a year and a half or 2 years, just to make sure everything is looking a-okay, and then we took it back to Mr. Endo up near Lake Biwa. So not sure exactly if that tree is still in his collection to this day, but I assume that it probably is. Let's scroll down again. So the next tree here is an oleaster, or what's called a kangumi in Japanese, silverberry. This is another tree that I'm not personally familiar with, but I want to contrast this tree with the one just below it, which is also an oleaster, so another kangumi or silverberry. You can see that the one above actually still has its leaves on it, and it also has the dangling silver berries on it. This tree, it's really up to the owner of the tree when they put it in the kokofu as to whether or not they want to show it off with leaves on it, or with no leaves, defoliating it just before the show, with the berries or without the berries. So my guess is this was a personal preference of this particular client to show the tree. And I would guess that the reason that they kept the leaves on, there's probably two reasons, and it could be either or. It doesn't necessarily have to be both at the same time, but one is potentially that the leaf size on this tree is so small, it's so fine, and maintained so well over the previous growing season that the owner felt that it was worth showing it off with those leaves still intact, because that in and of itself is a selling point, if you will, at least in terms of showing off the quality of the tree. The other thing might be that the berries, the dangling silver berries here, there's so many of them on the tree that, in defoliating the tree before you put it in the show, you might end up knocking off a lot or a majority of those silver berries. So that may be another reason why Fujikawa-san and that customer chose to leave the leaves on the tree. Now, if you scroll down to the next oleaster here, or silverberry. This one obviously has been defoliated for the kokofu. This tree was at Fujikawa-san's nursery from the day I set foot in the nursery until the year before I finished my apprenticeship. Is that right? No, it stayed a couple years after I finished my apprenticeship. So a year before I left Japan, this tree was still at the nursery. This one in that pot that it's in right there, it over time grew and the trunk got quite a bit larger in diameter, and it was no longer able to fit in this pot. I remember repotting this tree one spring. I think it was just after the kokofu, which is early to mid-February. So late February, Fujikawa-san decided to pot this tree up and up-pot the tree into a larger container. Well, we started potting in the afternoon. We took the tree out of the pot, started working the roots out, cleaned them out a little bit, fanned them out to some degree. We didn't cut any roots back at that point. We just fanned everything out. Well, he had to get called away for something, in the early to mid evening. So he didn't trust the other apprentices to pot the tree up on the proper angle by ourselves. So he told us to put the tree in the tenjijo, which is the unheated display room where we keep a lot of trees during the winter season. He told us to throw the tree in there and then just cover the roots up with a wet mofu in Japanese. It's like a wet, not cloth, but quilt, essentially. So to soak the quilt, cover the quilt, or cover the roots with a wet quilt, and then leave the tree, and we'll repot it the next day. So this tree sat with his roots out of soil for about, I'd say, probably 12 hours or so, maybe a little less than that, 10, 12 hours. And then we repotted it the next morning, and it didn't skip a beat. These things are like tanks as a species. They do super, super well, relative to bonsai culture and reaction to bonsai culture. And they ramify very quickly. So they can actually be defoliated at two different times of the year. You can defoliate oleaster, silverberry in February, January, February, and then allow the flush of new leaves to come out in March. Or you can defoliate them after the flush of growth has come out in March. Once the new leaves have hardened off by about mid-May, you can defoliate at that point as well. So you can really develop a lot of ramification in a very short amount of time. But this tree was always one of my favorite trees at the nursery. And the photo really doesn't do it justice. It looks a bit congested in the photo in terms of the branches, but it actually had very, very fine ramification to it. It was a really, really cool tree. So I was kind of sad to see the tree leave a few years back, but it went to a really, really talented client who actually traded us another tree for it. And that tree is actually further down in the gallery. So we'll talk about that tree in a few minutes here. All right, so the next tree down is a Hinoki cypress. Now this tree, if any of you guys have been following my work for a number of years, you will have seen this tree several times over the course of those years. This tree has been very famous since it was collected prior to World War II. It's a standard mountain hinoki, so Camassiparis obtusa. It is not a dwarf. So when it was collected, the foliage had that, you know, sort of elongating fan-like typical hinoki foliage. Well, if you look in the photo here, you'll notice that it's a very tight, very compact foliage. That's because this tree was pinched twice a year for, at this point, probably 60 years that you see in the photo here. And now today is an add another almost 30 years to that. So, you know, almost 90 years of pinching work on this tree, which is really cool. So there are a couple of ways to prune hinoki. One is to pinch them, and you will have seen this in some of my videos online or in my online intermediate course with Bonsai Empire. We actually featured this tree to show that pinching technique. The other way to prune them is to treat them essentially like a juniper, where you don't pinch the foliage, but you use scissors and you go in between the individual pieces of foliage and cut back to the semi-hardwood shoot. And that gives you a little bit more of a softer look to the tree. So, you know, when you look at this particular hinoki in the photo here, some people like the result, some people don't. It has a little bit of a pom-pommy effect or look to it. But if you see the tree today in person, there's less of that look. It's softened up to some degree over the years, and it looks really cool. It's a very interesting effect. But if you wanted to get a more sort of naturalistic, if you will, appearance to a hinoki, I don't recommend that you pinch it like this. And the last thing I'll say about this tree is that that bottom branch on the left side of the tree in this photo, if you look at current photos of the tree, that branch is no longer there. Well, it's not that it died off or got weak. It's that about 2 years after Fujikawa-san finished his apprenticeship at Bonsai-en, he was hanging out at his nursery, Kouka-en, and Mr. Kato came down to visit him. He was coming down for some business interaction with a client in Osaka, perhaps. But he stopped by Kouka-en and sat down and had tea with Fujikawa-san. And this tree was sitting just outside of the tea room. And Mr. Kato, you know, if you ever met him before he passed away, he was a very quiet man, very contemplative, didn't talk a whole lot. You know, he always looked like he was deep in thought, and he probably was. But he's sitting there on the couch looking at the tree, sipping his tea. And he looks over at Fujikawa-san and he says, "You know, you might want to cut that bottom branch off that tree. There's something that's not right about it." So Fujikawa-san, after he left, he thought about it for about a week, because, you know, you're dealing with trees that are, you know, tens of thousands of dollars. Making a big cut like that can be a bit daunting, particularly if that tree is already owned by a client. Got to get permission sometimes, or at least understand, you know, how the client might react to that treatment of a tree and the changing of a tree. But after about a week, he decided that, you know, that sounds like a good idea. So he went back and removed that lowest branch on the left side. So if you see the tree now, looks much more in proportion. It's less vertically oriented and much wider, and just feels more stable and much more powerful, I think, at this point. The trunk, of course, has thickened up tremendously since this photograph was taken here. It looks completely different. It's in a pot that's about twice the size of this oval pot that you see in the photo here. So it's gotten quite a bit larger. Okay, so let's scroll down here. The next tree is a kinzu, basically a dwarf kumquat. I'm not familiar with that tree. The next tree down is a Japanese black pine. Not familiar with that one, but that is very representative stylistically of how Fujikawa-san likes coniferous material to be styled. So that gives you kind of a general idea of what I was referring to with Hakuryuu earlier. If you scroll down again, there are two Japanese maples back to back here in the gallery. The cool thing about these trees is that both of them, they're actually sister trees. They're from the same, they're either air layers or cuttings off the same parent plant. So they're both a similar age, and stylistically they look somewhat similar, although the one below is a double trunk, the one above is a single trunk. The one on top here with a dark background, that tree was also owned by Mr. Endo for a number of years, but I have no idea where that tree is right now in Japan. The tree down below, the second Japanese maple with a double trunk, this tree is still at Fujikawa-san's nursery to this day, and I've worked on this tree many, many times over the course of the 9 years that I was there. It's actually quite large. It's 110 centimeters in this picture. It's actually a little bit taller than that now. This tree was owned by a very special client of Mr. Fujikawa-san, who lived in Himeji, which is about halfway between Osaka and Hiroshima. That client is a very wealthy client. I forget what he did for a living. But a few years ago, this would have been probably 6 years ago, 7 years ago at this point, he had had the tree in his garden for about a year. And then all of a sudden he had a really terrible health incident happen to him where he had to be hospitalized and he wasn't able to take care of these trees. And he didn't have someone who knew what they were doing there in time to take care of the trees. So this tree actually lost a lot of fine branching during the course of that summer after he went into the hospital. So we finally got a call from, I think it was his wife, asking us to come pick up the trees and bring them back to the nursery. So we drove down, picked them up, brought them back. And then over the last several years, Fujikawa-san has been nursing this tree back to health and rebuilding it. He might have sold this recently. Again, I'm not sure. I think he took it up to the Kokofu a year or two ago, and I'm not sure if he actually sold it off there. But this tree's actually been in the Kokofu several times over the course of its life. But as you see in the photograph here, I think this probably would have been in the early 90s. That would have been when the tree was really at its peak, I think, in terms of really fine ramification and, you know, just overall appearance there. But very, very interesting, very unique and powerful tree. Let's scroll down here. So the next tree is a Japanese maple. I am not familiar with that one, so we'll skip it. The next one is a display of dwarf star jasmine and an elm. Those two trees I'm not familiar with, but the following tree, Shinpaku juniper here. This is another tree that I styled during my apprenticeship. And again, this is another one that was owned by Mr. Endo. It's a very weird tree and it was very difficult to style and create a sense of balance in the tree. And I will post a link in the show notes to a YouTube video. I think it was featured in the Bonsai Art of Japan, which is my original YouTube series from over a decade ago. And I look like a baby in that particular episode. And my voice is incredibly high-pitched. So you'll see a massive contrast between this and that. I finally went through puberty. But you can see, you know, how I styled this tree relative to this photo. But, you know, very interesting, very unique tree, something that you don't really see very often. And again, this is a naturally occurring Itoigawa as well. So let's scroll down again. I think we've got, let's see, a couple more trees to talk about. The next tree is a literati juniper. I don't know that one, so we'll skip it. The following tree, though, this sort of double trunk looking shinpaku, the oleaster, the silverberry that I talked about previously, the one that we took to a client's house a couple years back and traded him for a tree, this was the tree that we traded him for. So Fujikawa-san had owned this juniper back in the early 90s, styled it, sold it, put it in the kokofu here with that client. That client then took it back to his nursery or to his home, maintained it for, you know, 25 years, almost 30 years. And then we traded him that Eleagnus oleaster for this juniper. So this juniper, it says it's 90 centimeters. It doesn't actually feel that large in person. And this is a naturally occurring Itoigawa, but it's the foliage is a bit coarse on it. It doesn't look like it in the photograph, but in person, it's quite a bit more coarse than what you see here. Two more trees left. So let's scroll down to the next one. This is another shinpaku that was at the nursery when I went when I was 16. It was still there when I started my apprenticeship. And in about the fourth year of my apprenticeship, I styled this tree. And I don't think I have any photographs that I can share with you guys after I had styled it. But if you look at the tree in the photograph here, the lowest branch on the right side, that one that's kind of got the droopy loop-de-loop on it, that branch died off over time. So it's no longer there. It's now a gin feature. And then the apex of the tree started to run significantly further away from the front. So a few years back when I styled it, we actually took a jack and cranked that apex forward towards the gin that's up there on the upper right side of the tree. So I was able to lower the apex significantly as well, so it looks a bit different at this point. Now this tree, a client came in a few years back and purchased it, so it's no longer at the nursery and I have no idea where it is. It might very well be overseas. Back a few years back when it was sold, the Chinese were really big into trees like this. It has sort of a dragon type look to them with a lot of motion and movement in the trunk, but much more stretched, a little bit taller, not as wide. So I have a feeling that this tree was sold to a Chinese client. So this is probably somewhere in China. So the last tree we're going to talk about is the next tree down, which is the stewardia here. This is another tree that my guess is a lot of you have seen online over the years. I've worked on it several times during my apprenticeship. And as a matter of fact, I styled this up for, I think it was the intermediate course with Bonsai Empire. So you can see how we bent branches, how we wired things back out to maintain this shape. But this is a tree, this is an interesting tree here. So Fujikawa-san's father, back in the early to mid, let me take that back. Probably the late 1960s to early 1970s, he purchased, I think, about 25 or 30 stewardia. They were air layers off of another tree, very fine leaves. But the air layers were at the base, probably only about an inch in diameter. And then they narrowed to, say, a pencil-sized trunk. And they were probably somewhere between 14 to 16 inches tall, so not very big. So he bought these air layers, brought them back to Kouka-en, and developed them for 20, 30, 40 years. So he kept working on them year after year after year, and over time he sold them off, the ones that he didn't think were going to develop into the best trees, sold them off. Well, this is the final one of those stewardias that is still at Fujikawa-san's nursery to this day. It's been bought and sold multiple times, but always been maintained at Kouka-en, despite the change in owners. It's been featured in the Kokofu several times, but this tree is really the perfect example of what the results you can get by proper pruning. So there is perfect taper, perfect but semi-natural, naturalistic anyway, taper from the base of the branch where they emanate from the trunk out to the very tips. You could never ever get this kind of result on a stewardia with hedge pruning. So this is sort of the embodiment of those techniques, those proper techniques. If you want to develop ramification, branch movement, branch taper, and a lot of branches all at the same time, this is the result of year after year after year of work. And the other cool thing about this tree is that there are absolutely no scars anywhere on the trunk. It's been completely container grown its entire life. You can see the wide nabari here in this photo. This photo would have been taken in the early 90s again. The nabari is probably a good 30% wider than it is in this photograph here, but the trunk hasn't grown that much. It's expanded a little bit, but the nabari has really spread out over time, and that's just a result of it having been maintained in a very shallow pot for so many years. But this is one of my favorite trees at Kouka-en. It will always remain one of my favorite trees in the future, and I'm always excited to go back to Kouka-en to see this tree each time. So that's going to do it for this episode of the Bonsai Network podcast. I hope you guys like this format. Trying to show visual work here is a little bit difficult, but hopefully you guys like this idea of being able to look at the gallery and sort of follow along to my descriptions of the trees. If you did, or if you think something should be different, we should change the format a little bit, send me a message to podcast@bjornbjornholm.com and we'll see what we can do in a future episode. Until next time though, take care and we'll see you guys in the next episode.
Thank you for checking out this episode of the Bonsai Network podcast. To have your questions answered in a future episode, please send them to podcast@bjornbjornholm.com. That's podcast@bjornbjornholm.com.